from Providence, Rhode Island. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Potterverse. It's a podcast dedicated to the book and film universe of Harry Potter. So grab your favorite wands and time turners. Let's step into the night and pursue that flighty temptress adventure. Hi, everybody, and welcome back. My name is Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and this is one of those times. This is the second time in four books that I've actually found it hard to like Snape.
Agreed.
This is...
Agreed.
It does not happen often. It does not.
Yes.
But it does in this chapter, and,
It's interesting because obviously this is a spoilerific podcast. We know what's happened. We know that in the long run, Snape is actually looking out for Harry in many ways. But we also know that he doesn't like Harry, that Harry reminds him of his dad. But when you're able to read it through the looking glass and you know the future and you know exactly what it is, you see Snape in different lights, like how we did in the last chapter where he was like, oh, Potter shouldn't do this. He's always getting into business. Maybe he was saying some of that to get him out. Mm-hmm. And yet in this chapter, you can't really play devil's advocate.
Yeah, no, you can't. But a lot of it isn't necessarily towards Harry.
Correct.
Though Snape insinuates that he's purposely going to poison Harry in this chapter. But it's against Hermione, and it's... The last time I felt like this was when he was just awful to Neville.
Correct.
And I think that is why I have a hard time, just being okay with Snape.
You can't love Snape.
You can't be okay with Snape.
It's a grown man.
Like,
look at us. We're like not even getting into the chapter. We're just like, we need to lay this out.
I know. Trolling on a 14-year-old.
Agreed.
That's hard for me to get. But you know what? Sorry.
Well, no. I appreciate it. And we are going to get into this, of course. Yes. All right. So, chapter 18, The Weighing of the Wands. 4 summers ago, on his 11th birthday, he had entered Mr. Ollivander's shop with Hagrid to buy a wand. Mr. Ollivander had taken his measurements and then started handing him wands to try. Harry had waved what felt like every wand in the shop until at last he had found the one that suited him. This one, which was made of holly, 11 inches long, and contained a single feather from the tail of a phoenix. That phoenix was Fox. Mr. Ollivander had been very surprised that Harry had been so compatible with this wand. Curious, he said. Curious. And not until Harry had asked him what was curious had Mr. Ollivander explained that the phoenix feather in Harry's wand, Fox's feather, had come from the same bird, Fox, that had supplied the core of Lord Voldemort's. Harry had never shared this piece of information with anybody. He was very fond of his wand, and as far as he was concerned, its relation to Voldemort's wand was something it couldn't help. Rather, as he couldn't help being related to Aunt Petunia. However, he'd really hoped that Ollivander wasn't about to tell the room about it. He had a funny feeling Rita Skeeter's quick quotes quill might just explode with excitement if he did.
Oh, Rita Skeeter is also... Oof. She's
another Slytherin.
She is something else in this
Slytherins
chapter.
Slytherins do not bold well.
The two best parts of this chapter involve Snape and Rita Skeeter.
Says the Slytherin podcast host. Okay, well, I disagree, but I would say the meanest parts, you know, and you really, the parts where you start to be fearful and you worry about Harry and his friends, yes, it's by these antagonists. And what's neat is that, like, it's just distracting us. It's distracting us from the fact that Barty Crouch Jr., a.k.a. Faux Moody, you know, is the one that has done this, that actually Harry Potter is in danger. And it's only really Sirius Black and Hermione and Hagrid in this chapter who've been constants, you know, in his life being like, buddy, you got to watch out. Something is not right here. Well, before we get into the rest of this episode, we want to thank all of you so much for hitting that subscribe button in your podcast app of choice. I would love to ask a big whole favor of you is that you head on over to Apple Podcasts and leave us a written review with 5 stars. It's going to help us be seen by more people who are coming back to Potter or are finding Harry Potter for the first time.
Yeah, especially now that the Secrets of Dumbledore is coming out soon.
Because of that, I will say we have fallen down the rankings in Apple Podcasts as the podcasts go. So do the Potterverse a favor. And if you have not yet written a review, write one for us. If you have written a review, go ask your best friend, go ask your kid to write a review for us. Let's get those reviews back up so we can be the top five again.
Are we going to do an emergency podcast for The Secrets of Dumbledore?
I mean, maybe, sure.
Yeah, we probably will. By the way, not in love with that title.
Well, let's discuss that on a different podcast, okay?
Fair enough. All right, here we go. Let's get into the show.
I solemnly swear that I'm up to no good.
In case you were wondering how much time has gone by, still not that much. It's actually November 1st, the day after Halloween. I feel like we've been here for a very long time, but this chapter does span a couple of weeks of time. So don't worry, time eventually does pass in the massive book known as The Goblet of Fire.
The Goblet of Fire.
In this book, Hermione, Hagrid, and Sirius have got Harry's back, and he feels a little bit better, even though the rest of the school, Hufflepuffs, Ravenclaws, and Slytherins included, think that he's a big old liar. And that Potter stinks. Oh, man, oh, man. Draco Malfoy and Harry get into a little bit of a tiff, which leaves Hermione getting some nice old beaver teeth. And then he's getting the weighing of the wands, and Rita Skeeter decides to interview him and adds a lot of stuff that wasn't necessarily true.
I love Rita Skeeter. I do.
I don't. And I'm so glad that at least I get to podcast with a Slytherin who gets to see things from different perspectives, because I already feel so conflicted with Dumbledore being a Gryffindor. Well, I know. She's good.
Well, why do you feel conflicted?
Because Harry is literally a lamb to be slaughtered in this series. A little boy is a lamb to be slaughtered.
I'm only in the third grade.
Well, you know how it is. So, yes. As I said, this all is still happening. So, one chapter on top of another. And, you know, when you're sitting there and you've got this big old book in your hands and you've realized...
You're not even halfway through.
You're close. But that's what I'm saying is that Halloween just happened. Yeah. You know what I mean? And there's still so much to go through. So this chapter, of course, really we spend a lot of time with Harry just feeling very left out, which I feel like is an ongoing theme for Harry Potter. Even though he is Harry freaking Potter.
Yes, that's true. If I could find it. There it is.
I'm Harry freaking Potter.
Even though he is the chosen one, even though every single person knows about him thanks to the history books, this poor child goes through years of just isolation. We think back to the Chamber of Secrets, where people thought that he, because he could speak Parseltongue, that he was the heir of Slytherin and everyone was worried about him. We've got him here now in the Goblet of Fire being hated by 3/4 of the school because they're stealing pride from Hufflepuff and Cedric Diggory. You know, we look forward to the Order of the Phoenix, where he's going to be called a liar because he stands there proudly and says, Cedric Diggory was killed by Lord Voldemort and he's back. Mm. And nobody believes him. We then go on even further where he's undesirable number one. Like, it gets so big that it's not just Hogwarts that hates Harry Potter, that is against him, that thinks he's a liar and a phony. It ends up being, you know, the mainstream media at the time. It ends up being all these different things. And I like to keep that in perspective because we're in Harry's point of view so much. We're in the magical world with him. We're with him being a hero and standing up, and we want to just give him a high five. And this kid has a rough life.
Yeah, that I think is due in part to his exceptionalism and the exceptionalism that he, I think, feels but also is subjected to. Harry Potter is special, and that is noted by Hermione in this chapter when she's talking about Ron, mm-hmm. saying, listen, Ron's just jealous and he's put up with it all this time, but this is the last straw. You're the chosen one. Like,
she doesn't call him the chosen one just yet, but she does say you're the one that gets all the attention.
I'm Harry freaking Potter.
And I mean, we play that as a joke, but it's true within the context of the text, right? His exceptionalism is both a blessing and a burden. It makes him a popular kid. It makes him Harry freaking Potter. But it also sets him up for some real low points. And you're right, Mary. His exceptionalism sets him up to be isolated.
You know,
because nobody can understand him from that point of view.
Yeah, I mean, just in general, fame, you know, we all know that there's two sides to fame. We all know that all the famous actors and actresses and singers, as much as some may like them, some may hate them. We know that they always get hate mail and blasted on social media. Blake and I, when we started podcasting, we started to get, you know, I just talked about those iTunes reviews. Oh, we started to get a lot of iTunes reviews, and a couple of those would be these scathing, wretched, terrible ones.
Why don't you divorce Mary?
Yeah, literally one of them said, why don't you divorce Mary?
She sounds like a yapping dog.
Thank you, person. You still haunt my dreams. But we ended up talking to a friend of ours who had been podcasting for a while, was really involved in the industry, and she said, when you start to get big, you start to get the haters. So know that, that when you get haters in any way, shape, or form, that that means you're actually getting bigger, and you're getting more well-known, and it just kind of comes with the territory. And here, poor Harry Potter obviously was going to have a few haters. He had the Draco Malfoys, you know?
Sure.
But at this point, it's not just that. It's not just that he's famous. It's that he's like potentially stolen fame from somebody else who a lot of people have deemed worthy. And what hurts him, I think, the most, because you see it time and time again in this chapter, is his longing to share something with Ron.
Yeah.
So here's my question to you. Who is in the wrong? Should Ron apologize to Harry? Should Harry apologize or at least like start a conversation to fix things with Ron? Who should or should neither of them done it, and should have just happened the way that it happens here in this book? Because should it have happened this chapter? And if so, who should have been the big one to do it?
Well, let's
keep in perspective, it's a 14-year-old boy's.
I know. So Hermione is very adult in this matter. She has the most emotional intelligence in this matter, and thank God that she does. The issue with this, and
can I make a note? Both Hermione and Harry were only children. And granted, Harry lived with Dudley, so it's kind of like a skewed only children thing.
Yes.
But I think that that, especially with Hermione, I think it allows her to have that omnipresence of like seeing the situation a little bit, because no matter what, when you have siblings, there is jealousy and you don't even realize it half the time.
Absolutely.
You know, there's this little like, I want to be better than them, or I want to get credit for that throughout your entire life.
Yeah, right.
Your entire life.
Well, the thing I like about this most,
at least I'm speaking for myself, but I'm Ron. So.
You are Ron. The thing I like about this most is that Hermione, she don't play no fools. She doesn't play the fool, and she doesn't mess around. Like, she is happy to talk to Harry or Ron about the other, but she ain't going to fix it for him. You know, she's not going to do that typical 14-year-old girl, get myself in the middle of everything and try to fix everything. Like, someone, I know.
How to tell when the hosts aren't listening.
I wasn't listening. Thanks, Blake. Do you want to recap? I took a moment to look at my phone. Oh, we're going to get another bad iTunes review. Oh. They're going to say Mary took a mental break for 30 seconds.
Mary doesn't care what Blake says. Why don't you just divorce her? How can you have a podcast you don't listen to each other?
You're gonna get blood to death.
Okay.
Oh man.
Sorry.
All right. So we're just gonna whistle past that joke.
Okay.
Because I don't want to pay for it later on. Okay. Here we go. She doesn't get in the middle of it, and she forces Ron and Harry.
Did you make like an X-rated joke?
No.
Okay.
I just made the joke about your character. It's okay. She doesn't get herself in the middle of things. And Mary, I think you could probably assume what I'm talking about here. She chooses not to get in the middle. She wants Harry and Ron to fix it on their own. And she is like, dude, listen, you do it. You talk to Ron. You should be doing it.
This is why I'm not Hermione.
The thing I would say about the situation is that neither...
I wouldn't have done that. I would have fixed it.
Neither are wrong. Ron or Harry. They're not wrong and they're not right either.
They're allowed to have their feelings.
And that's a mark of good writing from the author. Because again,
I mean, Ron is wrong in the sense that he thinks that Harry did put his name into the Goblet of Fire.
Yeah, but he's...
Ron is wrong in the sense that he thinks that Harry is withholding information from him.
Yes. So he thinks he's acting on what is true, right? So yes, could the situation be solved if they just talk to one another?
Yep.
Yes, absolutely. And that's the beautiful part about this writing, because again, they're not all wrong and they're not all right. If one person is wholly right and one person is wholly wrong, that's Harry versus Voldemort. Right? That is not a friendship. That is an antagonistic relationship. And you're always going to choose the right person. You have every right to be mad at Harry right now. It's incredibly frustrating for Harry to act the way that he does. And also, it's incredibly frustrating for the way that Ron acts the way that he does. And this is something that actually comes up again, mm-hmm. in later books, mm-hmm. for all you nerds out there, you know what I'm talking about. It's so frustrating. So,
and yet it's so real. And yes. This is the beauty of it. Like, long-term relationships do become almost this sibling-like energy. You know, you have to remember that Harry and Ron take every single class together. They sleep in the same room together. They're best friends, so they eat together all the time. And yes, Harry is used to that. He's saying, you know, I woke up, oh, and Ron isn't there. And, oh, I'd love to share this with Ron. And the information that actually Fleur Delacour is part Vila. Ron would love that. Oh, yeah, I'm not speaking to him. You're sitting here, and I'm sitting here as the reader, and now as, you know, adults that you and I are, Blake, and we're sitting here saying, Harry, just suck it up, man. Life is too short. You know, just go over to him and be like, listen, man, I don't know what's going on, but can we please talk? You know, go for a walk by the lake, feed the squid some toast, you know, because that was really cool that I did with Hermione. I didn't know it liked toast so much.
I raisin, love the
rye,
the big squid or whatever it is, octopus. I don't know.
The squid.
Whatever. Sure. Stats for nerds. Whatever it is, that might be my most favorite, like, tertiary magical character really? In the whole series.
I mean, I think you set your bar really low if that's it.
No, okay. No. You want to know why?
Why?
Because it only pops up a couple of times. You know, it popped up in the was it in this book? Where that turned over? That it turned over the boat?
Turned over a boat.
Yeah, for Dennis Creevy.
Oh, that he got, yes. 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 This, yes.
It only shows up a couple of times, but when it does, it leaves a mark. Harry throws the pen into the water, and all of a sudden, this just tentacle comes out and just takes the bread. It's one of those just random characters on a TV show that mm-hmm. just shows up, and you're like, that is wicked funny. And it doesn't insist upon itself. It's not like in your face. If you're paying attention, you get the humor. Mm-hmm. And I love that.
Something that I think is quite interesting, because, you know, as I'm rereading it now, sitting here, Hermione does try to tell Harry, please go speak to Ron. Yeah, yes. Well, you should go speak to him about it. So she does try her best without necessarily getting her nose in it. But what is also interesting is, you know, when you are in a disagreement with your best friend or with your partner and it consumes your life.
Oh, yeah.
It consumes your brain. You just can't function. Harry Potter was just put as a Triwizard tournament last night. Last night.
Yeah.
And what does he talk about most in this chapter? Not, oh, I really wonder who did it. Wow, this is really weird. He worries about
what's up with Ron. Yeah.
Oh.
It's a sign. It's a sign. Oh. It's a sign of great character.
Oh, and great friendship.
Great friendship. Yes, absolutely. And again, it's a testament to the author for this relationship that she has created. One that feels real and one that feels tactile. You know how each character is going to react. And that is a natural cycle of the characterization. Very special. You even get a natural sense of how Harry is going to react when he starts thinking about Snape. Mm-hmm. And like there is that part. I mean, I don't want to get ahead of ourselves here.
Okay. Then do to keep going from where we are?
You keep going. Keep going from where you are. Then we'll get to it.
Okay.
We'll get into it.
So Hermione does convince Harry to write this letter to Sirius, because Sirius did say, if anything further creepy weird happens, please let me know. Well, something creepy weird just happened last night, man.
Yeah.
So let's let Sirius know. Of course, he has to not use Hedwig, because Hedwig is just such an obvious owl, this beautiful snowy white owl.
Pissed.
Right? Hedwig is so mad. Harry gets upset because he's like, first Ron, now Hedwig's upset with me. Yeah. And, you know, he just has to use one of the school owls so it can't be detected. Something that I thought was so sweet as I was reading it this time, you know, obviously Hedwig is one of my top three favorite characters. And Hagrid picked Hedwig out. Like, he could have
picked anything.
Any of these other owls.
Yeah, yeah.
And Hagrid, who is a care of magical creatures professor, who is someone who works very closely, like, knew to pick such an intelligent, wonderful bird. Not just that she was pretty, but it really makes me think that Hagrid, like, yeah, he
got it.
Yeah, that it wasn't even necessarily Hedwig's looks that made him pick it. That, like, this is an owl that is really going to be intelligent and work well with Harry Potter. So, I don't know. I love that two of my faves are connected.
Again, there's more clues that Hedwig, in fact, understands every single one of Harry's words.
Yes.
My question to you, Mary, is that just an innate character trait of owls in this world? Or are there magical charms, or are there spells put on these owls so that they understand the words?
I will tell you, like, I don't know enough about owls. If all owls are magical and capable.
Sure.
I don't know.
That's it. You know what? Call out to the nerds.
Yeah.
Okay. Nerd clan. If you know that answer, you tell us.
Yes.
Because that's a good, it's a fair question.
That is a very fair question. Very, very fair.
Because, like,
I feel like they need to be trained.
Yeah,
like, you can't just, like, go into the woods and take an owl.
Well,
and
you
be
got,
like,
you got owls in classroom doing ABCs. Me?
Yeah. I don't know what that means.
Owls in a classroom doing ABCs.
No, I don't understand.
You're learning how to speak English?
Okay.
Are they doing...
Okay.
You know what, Marvin?
No.
You're on Mars today.
No, I'm not. I'm just not picturing Hedwig sitting there with a pencil, you know, okay, this is how I make an A. No, but being cared for since they were young, learning how to do... Like, you think about messenger pigeons or, you know, birds of prey, raptors that hunt for people. They have to be trained generally from a young age. So maybe that is part of it.
Okay.
And maybe owls are above the rest when it comes to other raptor birds of prey.
Fair enough.
I'm a huge fan of raptor birds of prey. We actually just saw a bald eagle today.
Oh, at least
so close to our car.
At least it was like 10 feet above our car.
That's it.
5 foot wingspan. Easily.
Mm-hmm.
It was like watching a dinosaur. It was enormous.
It was so big. And I have no idea what it's doing near our house, as we live in like complete suburbia in the city. But oh well. Have fun, Eagle. We're glad we saw you.
I know.
So, you know, once again, just kind of carrying on with the idea that nobody likes Harry right now. We do get a mention of some of the other Hufflepuffs who we've gotten to know over time. Justin Finch Fletchley.
The reemergence of JFF.
And Ernie McMillan not being the kindest, but I kind of get it.
Well, see, this is something that we should definitely debate.
Should the Puffs be mad?
Should the Puffs be mad, and should they be outwardly mad?
As the Ron that I am.
Yes.
The Griffin Puff that I am.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'd be mad. And henceforth, Ron is mad. He's mad just like the rest of the Puffs.
Yeah, but...
The Ravenclaws, on the other hand.
They don't care about nothing.
No, but they're not nice to him either.
Oh, no.
That's what I don't understand. Okay, yeah. I think that it is perfectly acceptable for the Hufflepuffs to be upset. Okay? The Hufflepuffs, like, never have a moment to shine. It's only been Cedric Diggory. Cedric Diggory helped Hufflepuff beat Gryffindor once. Once. In Quidditch. It was thanks to Cedric, okay? Thank you, Cedric. And now, this is their one moment to shine.
Yeah.
They're probably like, people are actually going to know what a Hufflepuff is. We don't know. But here we go. And Harry Potter kind of steals their glory again. And they've been nice all this time. They've been nice. They've bit their tongue.
Well, they weren't nice when Harry was talking about snakes.
Well, once again,
I'm out on JFF.
They're very loyal.
Fair weather friend.
I think actually they are fierce friends. Okay, let's use that fierce friend for Cedric Diggory. You mess with JFF, we're going to like bundle up and take care of our fellow Puff. And the same is happening here. I think that the Puffs take care of each other. Don't mess with the Puff. All those little bee badgers are going to come after you. Honey badger.
Honey badger.
Don't care.
Don't care. Yeah, but wouldn't you feel like they, nope, they would...
Don't mess with their own.
Say something along the lines of, yay, Hogwarts, we're all friends. No,
they're Tauruses like me.
Oh, okay. Okay.
They're kind and nurturing and protective, and they love to host, and they love to be outside. But you flipping mess with our herd?
If there's a Friendsgiving to be had, it's at a Hufflepuff's house.
You know it is. You know it is. But you mess with someone in their family? Oh, watch out. I am surprised Molly Weasley was not a Hufflepuff.
That's a good point. Yeah. That is a good point.
Don't mess with her daughter.
And that would yeah, that also hey, was a hey, good point.
Hey, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm giving JFF and Ernie McMillan a get out of jail free pass. The Ravenclaws, I got problems with them.
What do you got problems with the Ravenclaws for?
What do they got a problem with Harry Potter for? Slytherins already hate
Harry
Potter.
I'll tell you how. I'll tell you how.
Why?
Because he figured out how to get around the age line.
They're jelly.
They're jelly. Bam!
Just like that. A winner! They said,
you're welcome.
We're supposed to be the brightest witches of their age, and yet it's a Gryffindor named Hermione Granger who's the smartest, sure, in the fourth year. Like, what is that? You know that the fourth year Ravenclaws are being taunted the fifth, sixth, and seventh.
Trolled out of the planet.
They're like, you're letting a Gryffindor be the valedictorian? What's wrong with you?
When did Ravenclaws all of a sudden...
Your cousin from Boston.
You're letting a Gryffindor beat you?
Because they're from Harvard and MIT.
You have a bunch of Harvard dorks out there.
But that's what's going on. The Ravenclaws, yeah, they got their Harvard MIT hats, okay? They're saying we're the bravest and we're the brightest.
Nerds.
And now the bravest and brightest be repping from Gryffindor. No, you're right. They're jealous and they're upset that Harry Potter figured it out.
And remember, it was a Ravenclaw, one of the Ravenclaws that was with Madame Pomfrey.
Already tried.
Failed miserably.
They were like, if she failed... And yeah. Harry Potter, who's a fourth year, he's not even Hermione Granger. Maybe Hermione Granger, because she's wicked smart.
Yeah.
Maybe she told him how to do it. But still. Okay, you nailed it. Now we know why everyone's mad at Harry.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
The Slytherins. Hey, is Draco the one that makes the pins? Or is he the one that just like found out about the pins and like...
Draco has an Etsy shop on the side. Oh, yeah.
He has a whole studio set up.
Oh yeah.
In his four poster bed, yeah, you know, down in the dungeons. There's a whole lighting kit and everything.
his Etsy username is called the Sneaky Snake. And you know he has money, so you know he bought the button making kit as soon as he could.
He got the contraption with the
thing. He made a bunch of them for the Quidditch World Cup, okay?
Yes,
obviously.
Yes.
And now he has his button maker and he brought it to school, and Crab and Goyle are like, I don't know how to work it. And he's like, guys, it's fine.
The sneaky snake.
I'm going to make myself a little business. I don't want to have to ask my dad for penny candy money anymore.
Sure, yeah.
You know, I want to get the newest broom. I want to get the firebolt. I need to see if my dad told me to get a job if I wanted the firebolt. Okay, so I got a job and I sell buttons.
The great thing is that he is in full support of Cedric Diggory. Full support.
Yes.
And is it because it's just like, I hate Harry, so I'm going to be the Cedric supporter?
Yes.
And I'm going to be the one that goes ahead and does all
everyone would be rooting for Cedric, okay? That is their one champion for their school. So even though he got to meet Victor Krum, like, you're going to root for your school. You go to a football game and you root for your team, okay? Tom Brady's on the Buccaneers, but you're still like, I hope the Pats win. I hope they beat him.
Yeah, that's true.
Not gonna, but I hope they beat him.
They're gonna get smoked.
I'm gonna appreciate the moves he does.
They're gonna get smoked.
Okay, that's where Draco is.
Oh, Patriots.
With his button business. Then we go to potions. Oh, no, they have their feud. They have their duel.
Yeah, they got a whole thing.
When did they learn all these spells?
I don't know.
Bippity boppity boo. Like, 2 years goes by, you know.
Fernunculus.
Expelliarmus.
And Densagio.
What restricted book section books are Harry and Draco taking out in their spare time.
You know what
time.
It is? It's like
it's because Harry is a
no. It's down. It's down from student to student. You know when you like you're a kid and you do some shady stuff.
No.
And you're learning bad things. And no. You probably shouldn't be learning them, but you are anyway.
No, I don't.
It's because you're such a Hufflepuff.
Hufflepuffs can be naughty.
Well, naughty in
stop.
A good way.
Stop.
That's what's happening here. I'm sure that they heard it from this kid, who heard it from that kid who was, you know, who dropped out of school 10 years ago. And all he's doing is hanging out at Hogwarts because he's a townie. He's got nothing better to do. And he's still wearing his Quidditch robes because he thinks he's awesome. Mm-hmm. He's the one teaching Densaggio and Franunculus.
Okay.
That's what's happening.
They got those situations going on.
Essentially, he is the Matthew McConaughey in Dazed and Confused.
I don't remember that movie. Sorry.
All right.
I know. Okay. I know. But I just don't remember him that well.
Unbelievable, man.
Whatever, man. I've seen a lot of movies. My brain is like mush right now.
So Matthew McConaughey's I get older and the girls stay
really
the same
like
age.
I Matthew McConaughey. I don't dislike him as much as I dislike Tom Cruise, but Matthew McConaughey is not high up on my list.
Wait, you're out on McConaughey?
I'm not in. I tell you what.
I'm in.
Like, I wouldn't make him sit outside in a blizzard, but I would not invite him to Friendsgiving.
I am in on late McConaughey. Early McConaughey, kind of out. Because it was like, it was just one guy.
Okay, let's get back to Potter.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you very much. So we've got these two. We've got the Potter stinks buttons going on everywhere, and all the Slytherins think it's really funny. We've got Hermione there, and Malfoy says, "Want one, Granger? I've got loads, but don't touch my hand now. I've just washed it, you see. Don't want a mudblood sliming it up." So this is what makes Harry break.
Yeah, you just can't take
it.
It's
the
just,
insult against Hermione.
Yeah, that,
right?
I love that.
Some of the anger Harry had been feeling for days and days, which, like, why has it been days and days? It's only been a couple of days, Harry, okay? Yesterday was Halloween. Let's calm down, Harry. Or maybe it's not. Maybe now it's an extra day. He reached for his wand before he thought what he was doing. People all around them scrambled out of the way, backing down the corridor. And this right here reminded me of high school.
Yeah, absolutely.
When you start hearing, fight. Fine,
and everybody fine. Comes, and Hermione knows what's coming.
I don't come. I don't walk over, and yet I don't go over there, Blake. G-rated. I do not go over there, and I tell you what, the blood always ended up on my locker. What? Why? Why? Why do you have to fight right in front of my locker? I have a class to get to. Oh, I was not pleased with the fight situations. Let's do this.
Hermione knows what's coming. She knowingly says, "Harry," and then Harry just can't.
Go on then, Potter.
Yeah, I love that.
Moody's not here to look after you now. Do it if you've got the guts.
And for a split second, they looked into each other's eyes, and then at exactly the same time, both acted. And that goes to show you that Harry's actions, because he's mad and what he is doing, it's not good and it's not working out for him, because what ends up happening is other people get hurt. Other people suffer because of Harry's rash actions. Mm-hmm. That is hard for me to accept as an adult. As a kid, you kind of get it and you think about it. It's not my fault. It's fine. Blah, 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 blah. But no, you shouldn't have been there. You shouldn't have done it. And you should have just swallowed it and moved forward. But it's like that whole thing in Back to the Future. What are you, chicken? You know, like, who cares? You call me a chicken. Sure, fine. And as a matter of fact, he could probably learn something from Dumbledore in this chapter. We'll get to that in a little bit. However, I love this thing when Snape shows up and he says, "All right, what's going on here?" And Malfoy says, "Oh, he Potter attacked me. Look, he hit Goyle, yada, yada, yada." And he sends Goyle off to the hospital wing, and he forced Hermione to show Snape her teeth. She was doing her best to hide them with her hands, though this was difficult as they had now grown down past her collar. Pansy Parkinson and the other Slytherin girls were doubled up with silent giggles, pointing at Hermione from behind Snape's back. Snape looked coldly at Hermione and then said, "I see no difference."
This is where we get into the Snape hate.
Oh man, I'm
checking something up. I do want to say that I'm pretty sure this Densungio spell that Malfoy uses against Hermione.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure he uses this in The Cursed Child.
Oh, really? Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Interesting. Okay. All right, so, fair enough.
I'm going to, yeah.
We're gonna keep going with that?
Just, I know I can't talk about it too often much because you haven't even read it, so it's not even like a get into the spoiler territory, but nonetheless, I believe it's the same one.
So we talked about this at the top of the podcast, so I'm not going to, you know, go crazy over it, but this is when it's hard to be okay with Snape. And like, part of me thinks he's just trolling for the sake of trolling.
But the fact that it's against Hermione too, because there is sometimes when I think maybe he has to put on such a big act that he doesn't like Harry to kind of throw people off of his scent, because he is a double agent. He is going to be like keeping his eyes and ears open to the dark side to see how he can protect Harry. So I appreciate when he's meh with Harry. But when it's against Neville or when it's against Hermione, I just don't like it. I just,
well, part of me also make thinks, it right. Part of me also thinks that Snape was made fun of a lot. And it was by James and the other Marauders. But he was made fun of a lot. And this is his way of taking that control back from when he was a kid.
The bullies are frequently the ones who were first off bullied.
Right, exactly. So this is his way of saying, it's okay, not right, fine, though. Sure. Whatever. I'm not saying it's right, but you understand the pathos, but yeah, I'd say you understand the pathos behind it, the emotionality and the logic behind
it's
it.
It's just not right.
Sorry, go ahead.
Do you want me to blow your doors off or whatever you say?
Bake my noodle.
Okay. How sure are you that Malfoy tried to hit Harry and not Hermione? Hermione is already known for having big, bucky teeth. Malfoy specifically chooses a spell that grows teeth, and he just did something to upset Hermione, and then that is what upsets Harry the most. Did Malfoy on purpose do this spell to Hermione? I believe no. I believe it's just luck of the draw and that this was interesting for the author, but that is a debate. It's supposedly that their spells rebounded and that's what hit her, but I find it quite interesting that he's always hitting on her in regards to the mudblood comments and, you know, you gross me out. And Hermione is already known for having big buck teeth.
Well, let's look at what the text says. Jets of light shot from both wands hit each other in midair and ricocheted off at angles. Harry's hit Goyle in the face and Malfoy's hit Hermione. Goyle bellowed and put his hands to his nose where the great ugly boils were springing up. Hermione, whimpering in the panic, was clutching her mouth. Okay, so what we have here in the text is they looked at each other, in each other's eyes, then exactly at the same time, they both acted. Then, jets of light shoot from both the wands. They hit each other in midair and ricochet off at angles. My thought is they both shoot at each other and they go off in a direction that, you know.
Maybe he was inspired and he's like, I don't know what spell to do. Ooh, buck teeth. Okay, here we go.
Yeah, the text suggests that it was shot at Harry.
Agreed.
Though I like where your head's at, Mary, because if you're going to hurt Harry,
you hurt Hermione.
You hurt Hermione.
Harry can bounce back. Harry's been to the hospital wing more times than not. And so is Hermione.
And like I always say too, like, hey, you want to call me names? Fine. You want to pummel me? You want to get on me? Absolutely.
But you call all his day. Wife a yappy dog
you,
on an Apple podcast review?
You do something against my wife and you are dead to me. D-E-D dead. And you will never be forgiven and I will likely harm you.
Ooh, not so, really. Don't worry, friends. No, that's, G-rated. No,
it's absolutely true. Yes, you're right, Mary. I love where your head's at. And if this were a little bit more of an adult novel, I would say you're probably right.
But it's just interesting just to play with that. But don't worry, friends. Hermione's going to be okay. She's going over to the hospital wing, and in goes Harry into double potions with Snape, where everyone is learning how to make antidotes. Okay, so let's hold up a second. This is an area that a lot of people don't like Snape because he's like, I'm going to poison one of you. Here's the thing.
Yeah, he's not going
to kill you. He knows how to make antidotes.
Yeah, that's why I don't care about that.
We've got Madame Pomfrey.
Sure. Harry broke his, he lost every bone in his arm and he's fine.
Like, Snape saying I'm going to poison you doesn't really scare me.
No, it doesn't scare me either.
Because Snape won't let him die. They just want to like practice on somebody. It's kind of like when you are a lifeguard and you have to go to the lifeguard test and someone has to go jump and lay down in the bottom of the pool and act like they're drowning and you have to physically practice with a human body pulling them out of the water. You know, it's just sometimes you got to practice on the real thing. So yes. I'm okay with it. I think it just comes off so menacingly because of Snape. But I bet you if this was being taught by Moody or by Lupin and they just said it differently, we're actually going to poison one of you, but do not worry. Mm-hmm. I have the antidote. No one will die. Mm-hmm. But just so we can actually, you know, try your different antidotes on them. I think that would be great. I also think it's interesting because they need to know different antidotes. You know, Snape has now taught them since the very beginning with the Bezoar, like a different antidotes. And we're going to see in the future different, you know, poisonings and things like that. So
yeah, absolutely.
I think it's interesting.
Yeah, I don't really care that Snape's poisoning kid. I mean, like, I understand how that sounds. Sounds terrible. Mm-hmm. But I don't care that Snape's poisoning kids. They're going to be fine. I mean, totally fine. No one's going to get hurt.
Colin Creevy comes up. Excuse me, sir. I need Harry Potter because he needs to come.
Yes, we're going to do pictures.
He's famous. We're going to do pictures and do a write-up. He needs to take all of his stuff and he's not coming back.
I love how Colin Creevy, the first thing he says, talks about his pictures. Like, that's what he cares about most is taking pictures. And it has nothing to necessarily do with pictures. Holy, it's mm-hmm. more about the weighing of the wands. It's that's the ceremony to which they've been invited.
Which is a funny title because they physically don't weigh them, but it more comes down to evaluating the wands, that term of weighing, you know, really weighing the options against each other, not the physical weighing, just seeing how everything is. And it's Ollivander, he's back. Love Ollivander.
I know. Curious.
Curious, curious. I miss the fact that this scene wasn't in the movie. I would have loved to see Ollivander again, particularly because we see him again in latter film. You know what I mean? Like, Ollivander has this bookend situation in the books and in the movies, but in the books, he pops up, you know, specifically again here. And I love that. I love that we need to know that wands are important. Yes, they make the magic happen, but it is important for each person. So this kind of starts to go into the different wand lore.
Yeah, and I noticed too that Ollivander, all he does is just rank on the wands that were not made by him.
Oh, this is made by Grigorovich.
Not to my style, but I would have done this if it were me. It would have been like that.
I wonder who made floors. If it was Grigorovich, or if there's like a French artisanal, wand maker. You know.
Yeah, there has to be. But it's like, it's totally boutique.
Oh, you chose the Vila one? Yeah.
Yeah, I don't really deal with Vila.
I got it specially made. Like, I used my grandma's hair. Yeah. Ew! But fine. Hope she was alive when she gave that to you. Maybe she still is alive. Okay, cool.
Notice, too, that that the characteristics of the wands seem to match those that of the... contestants themselves. The one that Cedric has is rather springy, and Fleur's wand is really exceptionally inflexible. And what's his name there?
Crumb.
Yeah, thank you. Crumb's is rigid. So, and Harry's is supple. Now, I don't know what supple would be for a 14-year-old. That not the greatest look from Ollivander at that point, but I just like how the wands are reflecting the characters. And something, too, shows up. It also kind of plays on Fleur.
The definition of supple, bending and moving easily and gracefully, flexible.
Ah, okay. Fair enough. Thank you for that. I like how Fleur's is inflexible. And that kind of matches up with how she's acted so far. When Harry comes into that room and says, "Who's this little boy?" Mm-hmm. And then when it's announced that he's going to be one of the Triwizard Champions, she's like, "That can't be. That's ridiculous." She's the one who fights back. Mm-hmm. And she's the one who pushes exceptionally back against the idea of Harry doing that. So it shows how inflexible she truly is. Like that. I like building on that a lot. Building on those qualities that the author has already established.
And then, of course, we get into Ollivander checking out Harry's wand. And Harry's heart kind of stops for a second because previous to this, he had his run-in with Rita Skeeter, which we missed, but we'll touch upon that briefly. you know, so he's just nervous, like, please, Ollivander, don't say anything. I know you geeked out about my wand last time, and it is really weird, but, like, I kind of, I like it, so please don't let it know it's a little dirty secret, you know?
Right.
Because that is how Harry feels about it. And what's so interesting is that he, and I read this quote in the beginning of this podcast, because he likens his wand that is connected to Voldemort. It has the same core. It has the same phoenix feather that Voldemort's wand has, and is the only two wands that this phoenix gave feathers to. And he likens this wand to how it being related to Voldemort is kind of like Harry Potter being related to Aunt Petunia. You know, yes. Don't really like it, but it is what it is.
And yeah.
And what's interesting is that the wand protects Harry from Lord Voldemort. Petunia protects Harry because of the blood, blood situation, and how he has to live in the house. We end up finding that out later on in books too. But like, he has to live with Aunt Petunia and her family because that gives him protection while he is still a child.
Yeah.
So I just thought that was neat that his mind said, "Oh, it's kind of like Aunt Petunia." Yes, it is. Yes, it
absolutely
is, Harry.
And this idea of like placement and responsibility keeps coming up in this chapter, whether it is Harry talking to Hedwig and being like, it's not my fault. Mm-hmm. I can't use you. We need this. Or it's Hermione saying to Harry, you're just the chosen one. It's not, I know that you're not like that's just the card that you've been given. Or it's this whole thing of, it's not my fault about the wand or anything. It's just, that's just the way that it is. It keeps coming back up in this chapter. Do you buy all of this? That it's just, it is what it is, and it's not Harry's fault? Or is Harry, do you think Harry is...
I don't think it's Harry's fault.
Well, do you think Harry is... How do I want to put it? Is there any responsibility...
No.
...from Harry at all about what's happening?
No.
How come?
He's 14! Give him a break. It's just happened 2 days ago. What is going on? He doesn't know what's going on. His only family member that he can talk about has to communicate via owl.
Yeah, but yeah, there is a...
And Dumbledore, neither Dumbledore nor Professor McGonagall have taken the flippin' time to sit down with him since his name was chosen out of the Goblet of Fire and have a real honest conversation. Professor McGonagall, as the head of his house, should have said, Potter, I'd like you to have breakfast with me in my office tomorrow.
Yeah, good point.
Because I kind of want to know a little bit more about what's going on.
But there is, to me, a sense of Harry, don't be Harry about this. Harry, don't do, like in the last book when Arthur Weasley is saying, you know what, Harry, do me a favor. Do me a favor. Don't go after Sirius. Don't do this. Just stay home. Stay home, relax, chill out. That's all you need. And I get a sense that as Harry gets older, he is doing more to be the Harry, that, in quotes, that we all know. And actually, I want to go back real quick to the entrance here about Snape, when Harry was freaking out about Snape and how he was...
He wanted to crucio him.
Harry's ears were ringing. The injustice it made him want to... Oh, the injustice of it made him want to curse Snape into 1,000 slimy pieces. He passed Snape, walked with Ron to the back of the dungeon, and slammed his bag down onto the table. Ron was shaking with anger, too, for a moment. It felt as though everything was back to normal between them. But then Ron turned and sat down with Dean and Seamus instead, leaving Harry alone at his table.
Aww.
On the other side of the dungeon, Malfoy turned his back on Snape and pressed his badge, smirking. Potter stinks! Flashed once more across the room. Harry sat there, staring at Snape as the lesson began, picturing horrific things happening to him. If only he knew how to do the Cruciatus curse, he'd have Snape flat on his back like that spider, jerking and twitching. Antidotes, said Snape. There is a sense here that Harry is putting himself in these positions, like thinking, like truly considering hurting Snape, truly considering doing something to Snape that would put him in Azkaban for life, just because he felt like it.
Mm-hmm.
And you get the sense, like, when his ears were ringing, You know, I know you've been there when you're so mad you don't hear nothing except for ringing. I've been there too. Don't you get an idea that Harry would actually kind of do this if he actually really knew how to do it at this point?
I don't think he would Crucio Snape.
Why not?
He wouldn't unforgivable curse his professor.
Why not?
This is his home.
Yeah, but so
he's going to put it completely in jeopardy, and then he has to go live with the Dursleys. Mm. We all have had a teacher that we like really, really, really don't like, and we wish ill will against.
I've been there,
and but that's all you can do. You can't. You're not going to go to kid jail. That's your option.
That's true. That's a good point.
You're not going to go to juvie. No thanks.
You know. You notice too that Harry, though, as I've been talking about this, both Harry and Ron have been very passive, like. You're just waiting for the other person to solve it.
That's why I wanted to have that question. Who should have done it? And in my opinion, I don't know what conversations Hermione was having with Ron. But Hermione told Harry, you can fix this. You just got to go talk with him. So I assume Hermione was having the same conversations with Ron. But as we can only see things from Harry's perspective, I'm holding Harry a little bit more accountable at this point because he was given fair guidance as to how to solve this situation. And he pings and wants to talk to Ron the entire time. But Ron keeps hurting him. So I can appreciate that, too. I'd be mad. I'd be like, fine, if you're going to pout and go sit with Seamus and Dean, fine. I'll just stew over here and then later hang out with Rita Skeeter in a broom cupboard. Oh. Give me a break, Rita. No, she doesn't know. I highly doubt she knows unless she...
Oh, no. She absolutely does know. She totally knows. This is the woman that knows she wrote the book eventually about Dumbledore. She is the one that, like, she knows everything. Are you telling me that she isn't putting him in that cupboard? First, okay, number one, maybe she doesn't know, but the author does. So she's purposely doing that. Number two, she absolutely knows about the cupboard. That's where Harry, you're telling me she couldn't get one of her hands in one of them letters that was sent from Hogwarts to the house, the cupboard under the stairs?
There were thousands of them.
Yeah, they're floating around. It's like, you know, like those dust mites that are just... rolling around in the West. It's just Harry Potter letters.
I wonder if anyone ever kept any of those, if they just magically disappeared, or exactly if they just kind of blew around and people were like, guess what I found? It's like a Babe Ruth baseball. I have a Harry Potter acceptance letter. Me too.
She absolutely knew.
Interesting.
But it is worth noting that at least the author knew. And I like how the author tries to make Harry feel like a kid here, especially in comparison to Cedric, where he said, Harry notices that Cedric just looks like a champion, looks like he's the part. I think that's a big deal. And what Rita is doing here is showing you how dangerous she can be. The quick quotes, Quill, it is very funny, but also very, very dangerous, the way that it operates. I love this. Harry looked down quickly at the quill. The moment Rita Skeeter had spoken, the green quill had started to scribble, skidding across the parchment. Attractive blonde Rita Skeeter, 43, whose savage quill has punctured many inflated reputations. Oh, yes.
Never trust an object that can think for itself.
I totally agree.
That was an Arthur Weasley point, okay, when it came to Tom Riddle's diary, and it definitely is true here. This thing is a mind of its own and is going to cause massive difficulties going forward. Mm-hmm. I wonder how it works.
Well, they noticed that she like sucks it. On it.
Yeah.
Is that like to get
her kind of taste on the situation? Can it kind of read her mind temporarily? I don't know, but I'm here for it. And she just leans into it, you know? I mean, obviously this is a scene that kind of is a bit played out in the movie, so we really get the feel for it. She elaborates on Harry's situation, asking him over and over, you know, how do you think your parents would feel about this? Would they be proud of you? Would they be worried about you? And luckily, Harry is dragged from this for the weighing of the wands. It doesn't stay too long.
Right. But I do love how this is written. Can you remember your parents at all, said Rita Skeeter, talking over him? No, said Harry. How do you think they'd feel if they knew you were competing in the Triwizard Tournament? Proud? Worried? Angry? Harry was feeling really annoyed now. How on earth was he to know his parents would feel if they were alive? He could feel Rita Skeeter watching him very intently, frowning. He avoided her gaze and looked down at the words the quill had just written. Tears fill those startlingly green eyes. As our conversation turns to the parents, he can barely remember. I have not got tears in my eyes, said Harry loudly. Love this. I love it. Shows you the power of the written word. Mm-hmm. Kind of goes back to The Last Kingdom a little bit for me here, where the written word is what matters most. You could say anything you want to say, but whatever you got written is what's important.
Yeah.
What's his name? My favorite character almost in all of Harry Potter.
Yeah, so much that you really remember his name.
Kenneth Branagh, Gilderoy.
Did you like how I said Gil? Because yeah. I knew.
Gilderoy, written word. Doesn't matter what you did, written word. Same thing here with Rita Skeeter. Doesn't matter what you did, written word. Though, she does have a competitor. That competitor is one Albus Dumbledore.
Oh, shade in a way that you didn't even know it was shade.
Oh, goodness gracious. I love this. I hope you saw my piece over the summer of the International Confederation of Wizards Conference. Enchantingly nasty, said Dumbledore, his eyes twinkling. I particularly enjoyed your description of me as an absolute dingbat. As an obsolete dingbat. Mm. Rita Skeeter didn't look remotely abashed. I was just making the point that some of your ideas are a little old-fashioned, Dumbledore, and that many wizards in the street... I will be delighted to hear the reasoning behind the rudeness, Rita, said Dumbledore with a courteous bow and a smile. But I'm afraid we'll have to discuss the matter later. The weighing of the wands is about to start, and it cannot take place if one of our champions is in a broom cupboard.
Yeah. That's not going to work for us, Rita. So we'll reconvene on your rudeness.
Love this.
Kisses.
The cool, composed Dumbledore who just...
Kill them with kindness.
And what Rita Skeeter desires most is the power of her words. Mm-hmm. And when you deny her that power, that, Dumbledore knows, that is what just... digs it in even further on her when she, you're like, yeah, you did a great job. And, you know, I'd love to hear about it.
Yeah.
But you know what? Can't do it right now. We're busy. We got things going on. Sorry. When you neutralize that power, oh, it goes right into Rita Skeeter. It shows you the power of negotiation and how to mess with somebody.
Agreed.
So take what someone likes best and destroy it. That is the art of the game, I'll say. Anything else you want to say about this chapter, Marvin?
No, that's about it.
Are you ready for your...
Shoot, I feel like I different perspected the button thing. Okay.
Well, it's time for different perspective. You got one?
Let's see.
I know you got
Rolodex.
One. I know you got one. Here we go. Ready? And here we go.
Holy cricket. You're Harry Potter. I'm Hermione Granger. And you are...
Albus Dumbledore.
Albus! How are you today?
I'm a little busy.
Why? You got things going on. The Wailing of the Wands. Rita Skeeter's banging around here.
Harry freaking Potter.
Harry freaking Potter.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I'm Harry freaking Potter!
Uh-huh.
Curious. You know, that's one of Ollivander's favorite words when it comes to Harry. And it's just, I can't yet wrap my mind around what happened last night. Or 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Never mind. Because sure. Everything's stats are for nerds. Stats are for nerds. I'm very calm.
Yes.
In case you didn't know.
Well, why wouldn't you be?
I'm so calm that even when I'm told I'm obnoxious nitwit?
Obsolete dingbat. Yes.
You know?
Hey, whatevs.
I'm really glad she learned vocabulary at school.
Finally.
Yeah. had low hopes for her. What is it that that Frank Randall says? Oh. I had low expectations to begin with. And she met them.
Oh, you know what? I have to say, I have to do this because we just mentioned Frank Randall. Dumbledore, you mentioned
from Outlander.
You mentioned yeah. Frank, and yeah. I just have to.
And
for those of you watching the show today, I'm wearing my Wee Soldier On shirt just for Frank.
Just for you.
Sorry.
Awesome.
Continue,
so,
Dumbledore.
Yeah, you know, it's just, there's a lot of things going on, and... I'm kind of, you know, pulling for my friend during his alchemy days, Nicholas Flamel.
Sure, yep.
You know, being a scientist of sorts. Sometimes you just have to wait and see what happens. Sometimes if you get involved with things too much, you can frazzle things
Scientific
up.
Scientific method.
That's what I'm doing, man. I'm making observations, making hypotheses.
Hypotheses.
Yeah, I'm making those. Uh-huh, Nicholas sure. Flamel taught me that too. And I'm also just hanging out. I've got a lot of people over. You know, I've got Ludo Bagman. Can't feed him enough. I don't know what's going on with
him. Guy is a dumpster.
Seriously.
You just put more stuff into him. It just goes, keeps going.
But Harry Potter's struggling along, man. I thought he was going to break by now, but he hasn't. So I just keep playing Kelly Clarkson.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
And it's really happening for Harry.
Like, yeah, absolutely.
I put it through the school speaker system at night just to pump him up through like osmosis. It's working because I thought the kid would ask me. I thought he would come up to me and say, "Professor Dumbledore, mm-hmm. I didn't put my name in the Goblet of Fire. Can you please fix this? I'm Dumbledore."
Yeah, right.
I could have fixed it.
You could have done anything.
But he didn't ask.
Right.
So let's see what happens.
Hey, you know.
This is going on longer.
Who you got? Who you got in the Triwizard Tournament, by the way? Because this is the first time I talked to you since the Triwizard Tournament.
Okay.
And I just wanted to get your thoughts. So, you know, I heard the favorite.
I wasn't prepared for a long interview, but okay.
I heard the favorite, at least a plus 10 points is Crumb. And and the least favorite so far, at least minus 10 points, is Harry Potter.
Okay.
Who you got as your favorite? You got Floor, you got Cedric, Crumb,
really
you got Harry.
I don't care.
You don't care?
I don't care.
What, you don't want one of your Gryffindor, your Hufflepuff?
I just don't want a kid to die because then parents get nervous. And when parents get nervous, they pull the kids out. We stop getting donations.
Yeah.
So as long as a kid doesn't die.
Yeah. We're going to be in good
shape.
How about this?
As long as one of my kids
die. Because you don't care if Crumb or Floor dies. Whatever. That's their problem.
Stats are for nerds, right? Okay, end scene. That is like, I didn't know where to go.
Oh, that was good, though. I liked that. I liked that quite a bit. Good job, Marvin.
Okay, you're welcome.
All right, we got some emails here.
All right.
Ready to get into it?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Oh, Miles here.
All right, this one comes from Mara. She says, "I'm re-listening to your recap of chapter 13, and I have to disagree with Mary about Ron's use of Muggle curse words."
Okay, yes.
Ron is the son of Arthur Weasley, lover of all things Muggles.
Good point.
He has five older brothers who were likewise raised to embrace Muggles and mixed blood witches and wizards at Hogwarts.
Good point.
It is incredibly likely that he would become exposed to such words inadvertently or on purpose by his father, brothers, or his classmates before the beginning of his fourth year. We all regularly adopt words and phrases we hear. By the way of an example, my own kids regularly hear the phrase
"Not great, Bob,"
and "Bye, Ian," from me in their daily lives. That, for you nerds, is a Outlander reference. Bye, Ian. Much to my amusement and to their father's general confusion, the kids have gotten to the point where they know when and how to use those phrases appropriately in conversation. Ron has probably heard many Muggle curse words, but has adopted using phrases he can get away with at his age, since that is something that a 14-year-old boy would certainly
do. Love this!
I'm sure the author wrote many books, more books from Ron's perspective, especially after the time of book 7, we'd hear an earful of more.
Yes!
Thank you for all that you do. This one comes from Shay.
Hi, Shay.
Shay says, "I just listened to the latest Potterverse now, and you mentioned how Foe Moody seems particularly interested in teaching the kids how to throw off the Imperius curse. Do you think that this is because it was used on him by his father before he escaped?
Yeah.
Does it mean something more to him? I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. Thank you for bringing Lumos in my time of Knox."
Now, Shay, as Blake has not read this book, he knows nothing of what you talk about. You know, it's like a... You're a little Trelawney right now, but I'm here for it, and I'm here for all the spoilerificness. Yes, 100%. That is something that just ruffles his feathers, and he's like, "I want all kids prepared against this."
Yes. This one comes from Eric. "I've been meaning to write this email for a while. While some of your Potterverse podcast while looking for something new, I quickly binged through all the previous episodes and caught up with you 3/4 of the way through book 3.
Nice.
Mary, your different perspectives are fantastic.
Oh my gosh, thanks.
I must admit that I am hooked. I passed your show on to numerous other friends. Hi, Baker." Okay, Baker. Hi, Baker, what's going on? Baker, you can always call us in, write us an email, and I'll say your name right, Baker.
"Your cousin from Boston.
And since finding your show, I've acquired all 7 books on Audible and have listened to these series completely 3 times now. Perks of my job, being able to listen all day long."
Nice.
"In your last episode, the one for Mad-Eye Moody, you mentioned Trelawney being a nut job and is always wrong. Well, she's a nut job because, but she is typically right.
She is.
In that specific chapter, she said Harry must have been born in midwinter, and Harry responded that he was actually born in July. What Trelawney was actually picking up was the part of Voldemort's soul.
Dun, dun, dun.
Voldemort was in the fact born in December. Most of her predictions are spot on with Harry when you look at them through the end of the series. Now, Blake.
Do you remember
the
21st night of December?
Proud.
Voldemort's birthday. I think that's it, right?
It's September.
No.
Oh, okay.
I know. I'm asking when is Voldemort's birthday, Blake?
Whatever. I don't know. Sure, it's December.
I want to know if it's the 21st.
Okay, well, let's get on that, Mom.
Okay, fine.
Let's go. Let's get the nerds here.
31st. Do you remember the 31st night of December?
Now, Blake, you proud Slytherin.
Tom Riddle's birthday.
You have consistently proclaimed your love for Snape ever since the first episode. That's right. Snape is... Oh, man, that was a rookie mistake. Mm-hmm. Hey, actually, I just got a notification about Britney Spears' conservatorship being officially removed.
Blake, come on. Go with it.
Snape is the worst. You want proof? What would his actions have been if Voldemort decided that the prophecy was about Neville? He probably would have kicked into Longbottom's door himself.
Preach.
And bowed to let his master enter. And the big True. Secret that he always loved Lily was just so creepy. She didn't approve of his friends he kept, the actions they were taking, and in the end, she cut him out of her life completely for good
peace
reason. His redemption was a facade, and I firmly believe he would have gone back to Voldemort fully if Harry died in the astronomy tower with Dumbledore. Anyways, love the show. Keep up your fantastic work. Okay, listen, Eric. Okay, number one.
Love it, Eric. Okay. I'm here for it.
All I'm going to say is scoreboard, Eric, okay? The score is the score.
Particularly in this chapter where we were like, we can't be on the Snape train right now. Love that we got to read your email.
You can't say, well, if this and if that.
That's all we do.
It didn't happen.
That's literally the different perspective.
It didn't happen. What if Harry was born what if the sun turned into a black hole the day Harry was born? None of this would have happened.
You were just about the buck teeth conversation. You were like, this is really cool. Let's talk about this.
That's because it actually happened. If Neville this, if Neville that. You know what? Scoreboard.
Ignore Blake.
Didn't happen.
Ignore Blake, Eric.
You are what your record says you are.
Move on. You're rude.
Just having fun. Come on. Having a little fun.
You're just loud.
I know. That's the idea.
You're a little aggressive.
You want to know why? It's because...
Your cousin from Boston.
I've spent all day with Blake today, and it's just been a lot.
That is it for our emails.
Thank God.
If you have sent... if you have sent some more recently, we will get to them. It's just I had to get through our backlog of the emails that we had. So I had to get them all out. So the more recent ones that have been coming up, you will be put on next episode. All right, Marvin, that's it. Got anything else?
That is it.
Let's close this show out.
Do you remember the 31st night of December?
You're not going to let that one go, are you?
No. I have to find the rest of the words now. It's going to be amazing. It's going to be so amazing because his birth origin story is freaking crazy.
Voldemort was born on New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
That's wild.
Yeah. And his dad was in the love potion.
Oh.
Freaking crazy, man. Okay. So thank you all so very much. As I asked earlier, please, please, please take the time to go to Apple Podcasts. Even if you watch us on Facebook or YouTube, do us a big favor. Head to Apple Podcasts, as that is where most people are finding the Potterverse. Leave us a 5-star review plus a sentence or two, as that really, really helps other people find us. We do have a complimentary texting service. So if you wanted to join in the live discussions on Facebook or YouTube when the video aspect of the podcast comes up, make sure you get out your phones. If you're in the US, the number is 81010 and the message field @ElderWand. So the @ symbol ElderWand, all one word, no spaces. 81010 @ElderWand. And if you are out of the country, out of the US, you have to go to remind.com/join/ElderWand and you will be on the complimentary service.
That's it. That's all we got.
That's it. That's it, friends. Thank you ever so much. My name is Mary.
My name is Blake.
Mischief managed.